I'm here with Zal, director of Sound of My Voice. How are you doing?
I'm well.
I wanted to ask you, first of all, obviously we've worked with Britt as a studio before. What is it like sort of collaborating with her? How did you guys sort of find each other? How did that collaboration sort of come about?
Well, Mike Cahill, who directed Another Earth, which you can download.
Oh, yes.
On Amazon or iTunes.
iTunes. The link is on the blog. Check it out.
And I met in college, and we both wanted to make films, but we didn't know that people could do that. And so we finally started to make a film, a short film. It was actually Mike's idea to just start it. And when we finished that film, we submitted to the first ever Georgetown Film Festival, because we were going to Georgetown University at the time. And we won that film festival, and we were brought up on stage, and there was a standing ovation for us. And leading that standing ovation was a 17-year-old girl clapping really big, and I was like, Mike, look at that girl, she's glowing. And that was Britt Marling.
Oh, that's so cute. I kind of want to ask you about science fiction a little bit, because I'm a big science fiction fan, because it's such a good medium for a bunch of different stories. Like, you can get a lot of humanity, a lot of, like, speculation about life, etc., out of science fiction. What sort of drew you to science fiction as a genre for this film?
I don't know. I guess I was just a kid who was always drawn to science fiction and magic and things like that. Like, time travel is something that's fascinated me since I was really young. And so it was sort of a no-brainer to me that the genre would be something I would work in when I got older. So I love science fiction. So. But I think it's a lot scarier when it feels very real. And I think the thing with Sound of My Voice is that, you know, it combines the mystical with the mundane. And, you know, when science fiction becomes more science...
More like fantastical?
Well, no, the other way around. Like, when it's more like, well, what if it isn't real? Isn't that even more magical in some ways?
Yeah.
I love that space.
Yeah, and I feel like the film definitely, like, kind of lives in that space, because you do have, like, the basement, and you have, like, the road and the oxygen tank, and there are all these things that exist in the real world, and obviously without giving anything away, it does sort of feed into the enigma of Maggie being like, well, if she can use all these mundane things, like, how real is her claim, etc. At least that's what I felt.
Yeah, exactly. If she's sick and dying and all that stuff, like, and she has amnesia, does that amnesia further prove that she is a time traveler, or is it just part of her long con?
Yeah, exactly. So where did sort of, like, the germ of Sound of My Voice originate? Like, where did the idea for the story come from?
Well, I had a dream in which my hands were bound by plastic cuffs, the actual plastic cuffs we use in the movie, and, my eyes were blindfolded, and I was wearing a hospital gown, and I remember because it was, like, very breezy, and I was led down these basement stairs, and I told that dream the next day to Britt during one of our writing sessions, and she didn't miss a beat. She was like, in that basement, there are all these people, and I was like, why are there people? And she's like, well, they're there because of this woman who never leaves the basement. And so we started telling each other the story, and whenever... we would tell each other a part of the story that would cause the other person's eyes to light up and for them to lean in. You knew you had a good part, you know, you had a chunk. And whenever the person would glass over and start checking their phones, you knew that you didn't have a part of the story. And we spent 6 months doing that till we had the movie.
So obviously there's more sort of to the film, to the story, that meets the eye. There's a lot that isn't said. There's a lot of sort of speculation. I know you can't talk about it, but just for my own sort of, like, peace of mind, how big is the scope of the actual story? Like, how much of a detail is the actual duration of Sound of My Voice to the...
Right. So...
canon.
For a movie like this to work, you have to figure out everything else. Because you can't just show... To show less, you've got to figure out more. And so the whole thing's mapped out for Britt and I. The world is mapped out, what the characters' interactions are, and then... Sound of My Voice is sort of book one.
Okay, so it's the beginning.
It's the beginning, yeah. And it's a pretty good chunk of it because it puts everything into motion. But those characters definitely come back. I mean, we'll see if it's up to the audience, if they really want it or not.
Yeah, sort of. Do you have sort of a time frame, not in the real world, but within the story, for a sequel or a trilogy, or like, what's the, you know, if like the perfect world you were able to make.
Well, the next part happens pretty, like, you know, a month or so after this.
Okay.
In the world of the story, but you know, little Abigail's getting older, so you're gonna have to rewrite that.
Just recast. It's fine. They do it on Mad Men all the time. They're like 15 kids. You're working on The East now, which we'll be putting out next year. How has sort of that experience working with, you know, not the same people, but like the same sort of environment, is different from Sound of My Voice? What is that? Because obviously you made Sound of My Voice low budget. Ultra low budget, super shoestring. And now you're making The East with us. Like, how do you sort of prefer it? Or how are the two experiences sort of matching up?
Well, I mean, I actually don't notice that much of a difference, ironically. I think that filmmaking for me is like digging more than anything else. So Britt and I start digging, and you know, we dig out some enough to feel like a curvature. And so then other people come on board. The amazing cinematographer comes on board, or production designer. I mean, in the case of The East, I mean, next level shit, as my brother would say. And then the actors come on board. And in both Sound of My Voice and The East, we've had such great actors, and Sound of My Voice, Chris comes on board, Nicole Vicious comes on board, Davina McFadden, who plays the Justice Department woman, they come on board and they start digging. And then, you know, in the case of The East, Ellen Page comes on board and she starts digging with us. Skarsgård comes on board and takes two shovels and starts digging. Ms. Patty Clarkson is sitting there digging. And then after a while, you know, you have this structure, and it doesn't belong to anyone, it just is. And we've all worked together to uncover it. I felt that when we were making Sound of My Voice, and I feel that with The East. So you're so busy digging that you're not thinking about, like, oh, well, this has nicer food. P.S. Sound of My Voice had nicer food than The East.
Good to know.
Because we had this vegan chef who was amazing, who'd never done movie food before, and she was making homemade jams, and we had fresh bowls of fresh fruit. And, you know, when everyone's working for free, you have to really...
Got to get the perks.
Yeah, you got to give them something.
Speaking of it, how did you sort of cast the cult members and everyone's Sound of My Voice? Because it feels very real. It feels like, you know, they're actually a cult. Or it feels like, you know, how did you sort of go about the making of that group of people?
Yeah, well, we cast every single person so carefully. It took us days. We had these great casting directors who sort of came on board, you know, doing it for the love of the project. And we had really intricate backstories for each of the members of the group. So we had them read monologues that we had written for them anyway. And so talking about why they had joined Maggie's group. So it was a really fun process, and then it was really fun on set. Everyone brought their backstories to the work. And I think, you know, it shows in some degree in the film.
Yeah. I want to talk about the story more, but I don't want to give anything away because I'm posting this today. So I'm going to stop, but maybe we'll do like a follow-up at some point once the movie's out for a little bit. And we can kind of like extrapolate a little bit more. Anyways, Zal, thank you very much. It's been a pleasure.
Guys, go see this movie opening weekend. Don't watch this preview until after you see the movie.
Thanks, Zal. Thank you. All my hard work gone to waste. Thanks a lot.